Thank you all so much for coming. We're going to go ahead and get started here. Thanks to the folks on Zoom. It's really good to see that lens in the back. I'll imagine your smiling faces. For those of us in person, we're here today at Site Santa Fe. I want to acknowledge that Santa Fe is on Tewa land, home of the northern Pueblos. So my name is Han Santana-Sayles, not like Han Solo, more like ham sandwich. I'm the director of artist collaboration at Meow Wolf, and I'm joined here today by my colleague, Chadney Everett, waving in the front row. Chadney was the senior creative director for the Convergent Station exhibit in Denver and is now the creative director for projects at the House of Eternal Return and worked very closely with all of these artists tonight. So thank you again so much for being here. Meow Wolf really exists because a group of artists had a vision that collectively they could build something monumental that none of them could build alone. And in the beginning, that monumental thing may have looked to some like an immersive trash pile, but in reality, it was always about building worlds together. And in the words of Matt King, Meow Wolf co-founder, our goal is to transform people's perception of reality by awakening the latent magic and power within each individual. And in my own words, it is such an honor to invite these artists into the fold from Santa Fe and from across the country to participate with us in creating the world that we all want to live in. So thank you. Every year for the past 5 years, we do this thing that we call rotations, where we change new rooms or elements of our exhibits. This really gives us an opportunity to engage guests, have fresh work. It gives Meow Wolf an opportunity to be in dialogue with a lot of really brilliant artists, and hopefully gives the artist an opportunity to work at a uniquely large scale and with a wide, diverse audience who will see their work who maybe wouldn't have before. So we're really happy that you're here. This is our inaugural artist talk, so thank you so much for coming. Tonight you're going to hear from our 2022 rotations artists, Virgil Ortiz. Lauren Young-Smith. and Jacob Fisher. You're going to see special sneak peeks before it's open to the public in just a couple weeks, and a chance to learn about these artists and really incredible people who I am confident you will be obsessed with, as I am. I'm going to invite each artist to come up and talk about their existing body of work and also talk a little bit about their project with Meow Wolf and this process for them. And then we're going to host a conversation where we ask them questions, and then we'll have Q&A. So if you have that burning question, hold on to it. If it gets too hot, I think, you know, it's probably a fire extinguisher in the back. Thank you for entertaining that dad joke. I would also like to say that we're very participatory. So if you see something that you really like, you know, you can do like the poetry snaps. You could do like, ooh, ah. Just, you can express. You're free to express. And I also want to say thank you so much to Site Santa Fe for hosting us. They were a very early Meow Wolf supporter. Before my time, they gave funding to the Do Return, which was a very pivotal moment in our history. So it's great to be back here and be hosted by them. All right, so without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first artist tonight, Lauren Young Smith. So Lauren Young Smith is a Los Angeles-based artist whose work is influenced by multiple stages of focus, both geographically and in practice. Carrying a BA in English and Fine Art from Stanford University, yow, Lauren applies her dynamic bouts in academics, literature, illustration, comics, and animation within their role in the urban art sphere as a queer Asian American femme with a deep passion for visual storytelling. Their signature style of high chroma design elements interwoven with dynamic portraiture creates lush, florid pictorial portals to worlds that are as just as they are visually captivating. Lauren's work seeks to bring an element of the fantastical and narrative fluidity to the dignity of their characters' personhoods, with a specific passion for creating space for queer and BIPOC stories. From large-scale murals to multi-layered work on canvas, Lauren's work draws inspiration from queer worlds, non-binary identities, mythology, dreams, psychedelia, animation, cybernetic organisms, travel, nature, human dignity, metaphysical wonderings, and their mixed Asian American heritage. And if you're not familiar with their work, you're like, there's no way that something's going to do all that. But it really does. Lauren's vision encapsulates their lifetime search for identity and selfhood, a love of local myth, and the constant pursuit of promoting anti-racism and just futures. So please help me welcome Lauren.
Oh, I'm short. Okay. Is that okay? Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Han. Thank you so much, Meow Wolf, for having me. I'm so happy to finally be here after many months of working. This is the largest project I've ever taken on, like, by myself. And so it just feels really good to be here and see things going up. And it's really nice to be back in the Southwest. I'm from Colorado, so feels like home. Okay. Thank you for the intro. I will just do my best to not take too much time up. There's a picture of me. this is just a few images of my body of work, just to give you like an intro into what I do. This is a mural that I painted. My main focus is mural painting, so installation is very new to me. But this is a piece I painted in Sacramento. It's an homage to the immigrant Chinese railroad workers who built the Transcontinental Railroad starting in Sacramento. I've been spending a lot of the last few years focused on trying to like put a spotlight on the stories of Asian American immigrants and talking about how they built the backbone of this country, and then bring awareness to the way that we all have connections to our roots and our ancestors, and need to like pay attention to the way that the country was built. Especially, obviously, it was connected to what was happening in the past few years with hate crimes. I just found myself really obsessed with doing research and finding out more about my heritage. I'm half Chinese, third generation, and trying to tell these stories in a way that's not, because a lot of these stories are kind of dark and heavy in politics and like, you know, the rife history of the railroad workers can be kind of dark. So I'm trying to give it sort of a fantastical, like psychedelic feel while telling a story. So that's what's happening in a lot of my work. And everything I do is freehand. So this is all freehand, no projectors. This image on the left is painted at the Yale University Asian American Center. A real honor to have painted there. And I was focused on, you know, telling stories about the students and their history of activism, the Asian American population, or the student population at Yale. Did a ton of research on that. It was a huge honor. I love this piece. It was, a really great challenge working on the brick. This piece on the right is in Nanshan in China. It's actually, well, it's a Mid-Autumn Festival right now, so happy Mid-Autumn Festival. But this is this is Chang'e, who is the moon goddess, and she lives on the moon. This is at the Chinese American Museum in Los Angeles, and this is a portrait of my queer elder, Peter Lai, who has been a huge influence on me and had some influence into the installation I'm making, because focus on protecting our elders and elder worship and taking care of the people who paved the path before us, especially queer people, has been a huge focus of my work. So, and he's a huge figure in LA history. He's like this magical queer fashion designer who has taught me a lot about what it means to embrace my identity. And so I thought I wanted to like pay homage to him, give him the flowers while they're around, because I lost my grandparents within the years before the pandemic happened. And sort of when that happened, I started making work that was about ancestor worship and connecting with my roots and the people who are no longer around us. So my work has sort of expanded in the direction of that. And that's a huge part of what's happening with the room that I'm making at Meow Wolf. This is the other side of the mural. The character in the striped sweater is a portrait of the woman. I mean, there were a lot of like horrific hate crimes that happened in the past several years, but she was one of the people who, she got attacked in the streets of San Francisco and then she beat the guy back with a bat. And then she donated all the money that got donated towards her back to the Asian American community. So she's one of my heroes. So I just love elders. And my studio is really close to Chinatown, so I spend a lot of time like going there and buying objects from the elders who've been there forever, and you'll see more of that later on. This is in Santa Cruz. This is a good example of how I try to warp or like sculpt my visual storytelling in a way that is both fun to look at, but is also doing some kind of social justice work. So this is about how the sea urchin population is destroying the kelp forest in Santa Cruz, which is actually a huge problem that's going on, but I really love anthropomorphizing issues in a way that can tell a story, but is also like, you know, fun to look at and has influences from punk culture and skater culture that are drawn from Santa Cruz. On the left is a mural that I did for Pride, I think 2 years ago now, Queer to Stay. Was a great initiative designed to support queer-owned businesses in LA through the pandemic. And they gave me a ton of freedom to paint what I wanted to, and I decided that I wanted to portray queer people of non-binary identities, of color, sorry. Because I don't think there's a lot of representation within murals of people who are non-binary, identify as non-binary. And so I found artists in lots of different areas and mediums, music, poetry, photography, who I really admire and wanted to do portraits of them to talk about how we need to have more representation to physically take up space with like the public art we have as well as take up space in our own lives. I need to remember to breathe. On the right is also another example of a piece I do for environmentalism. It's about plastic recycling. This is in Boston. Okay, so that's an intro to my work, some of the stuff I do. And then this is crazy because I haven't seen it since I pitched it, 7-8 months ago. But this is the plan for the room. It's called the Ancestral Crypt. And when I saw the room, I drove out here to see the room, which I'm really happy I did because it's such a weird room, in a great way. And it's in the middle of, like, it's in the heart of the magic forest. And to me, it always felt like, I feel like I'm going into this sort of temple space inside of a tree that's, you can't tell if it's underground or in the ancestral plane or whatever. And I wanted to expand on what I've been doing with my I've been making these like rotating pieces that are designed off of Chinese altars in Taoist religion and a lot of Chinese like traditional Chinese homes. There are altars in the home where you light incense every day, as a way to connect with your ancestors. And I never really believed in it. I'm third generation, so I'm very Americanized. But after my grandparents passed, I had this sort of like shake wake up call where I was like, am I even Chinese if my grandparents aren't around, if I can't talk to someone who speaks Chinese who I'm like blood related to? And so I felt really untethered from who I was. So I really threw myself into researching Chinese mythology and history and things that I could understand, and then building altars of my own making. While I was insecure that I wasn't doing it the right way, but what I've realized over the past few years and in the making of this installation is that the Asian American experience is so much about questioning. Like, so many of us don't know exactly what it means to be fully what we are, because being mixed or being non-binary or being between races or sexualities means that you get to make your own path. And part of that is questioning. So for me, making these sort of altar pieces in my own way that feels good is like my way of defining my Asian American experience. So that's part of what we're doing here. it's gonna maybe look like this, I don't know. Okay, on the left here are some bats that I made with my team. That'll be part of the installation. On the right is a picture of Peter, my elder, who I painted the mural of. And he came from a family who had a history of Chinese opera. And he's also like one of my idols in terms of gender fluidity. And he is like the only male person who is in his dance crew. So he's like, he's been doing gender fluidity for much longer than I have, or like the younger people. And I look to him a lot to think about how like our ancestors were fluid much before. It's not a new thing. It's not something we're like trailblazing. It's actually reaching back into history to reclaim. These are some of the paintings that I was doing to create the murals that'll be installed in the space. These are tomb guardians on the right that are based off of Shi Wang Mu, who's in Chinese history is Queen Mother of the West and protector of the femme. And then these are sort of like vignettes that tell stories about queer and trans love throughout history, but also psychedelic and futuristic. On the right is actually Peter's altar, which shows these ancestral portraits that are really traditionally in Chinese homes. But I did my own version of them. And then on the left is, I just threw this together too, like from pictures from my phone. I haven't even looked at anything yet. But we were just buying items from Chinatown and sort of revamping them to look futuristic. And I really love this idea of taking things that are antiquated and feel like they're from history and then like altering them to make them feel like they're from somewhere else. But like reaching back around, you know? To create a new present. This is Una. There's a lot of pictures of my team, and because I wouldn't be here without them. But yeah, this is our dog friend Una, wearing the Tuershen mask. Tuershen is the rabbit deity or the leveret spirit in Chinese mythology, who is protector of the queers, which you wouldn't think if you didn't do the digging would be like a thing that happens in Chinese mythology, but it exists, and I'm really obsessed with it for that reason. Oh, these are the ancestors on the left. They were upside down. I learned how to sculpt during this process, thanks to my team. That's a Qilin, which is a Chinese unicorn that will be part of the installation. These are all more items that are bought traditionally to put into altar spaces they're incredible. It's just having found materials from my heritage and from my friend's heritage is like such an amazing thing to be able to work with. On the left, that's Peter and my girlfriend, who is like a huge inspiration for this space, but like the style is sort of comes from this like, you know, futuristic heritage standpoint. On the right is friends from my team working on these audio recordings that we're including that tell sort of like folk tales that we've written or that Sarah Liu has written. Sarah's half Korean, also like love combining other heritages, like Asian American heritages into the stories, had a lot of influences. I have a lot of friends and collaborators who are Japanese, like contributing music to the space just to give it like more of a mix. This is a mural piece that will be rotating, I believe, when we get it up. And it's about, you know, mixing identities and mixing genders. So all the rings will like spin in different directions and talk about how, you know, gender is not a destination, but it's a journey, as well as sexuality and identity in general. Dirty studio. This is Sarah Liu and Zach working on this altar space, which is another homage to Tuershen. You can't quite tell what's in there, but these are also more items we made from Chinatown and updated. Oh yeah, there's the altar, hopefully, yeah, in sort of like a nascent stage. some more murals that I created. Centipedes are symbolic in Chinese medicine. This is Tara working on the masks that will be on the ceiling, which are sort of repurposed no masks from Japanese theater. And it's designed to sort of like give you this feeling like you're in a space that's being watched over by the ancestors. This is me painting this head that we just put up today, which is crazy. This is sort of an imagined deity that we just managed to pull up thanks to the Meow Wolf team. Again, psychedelic, futuristic, Asian mix stuff. This is the last picture of Shannon working on Tao Bo, who is the Qilin on the front of the crown, which is designed off of Chinese opera crown stuff. I feel like I've gone way over, so thank you very much. I appreciate it. Any questions?
That was great. I want 20 more minutes, Lauren. All right, but I'm very excited to introduce our next artist. Jacob M. Fisher is an American installation artist living and working in New York City. He earned his BA in studio art from Bard College in Annandale-on-Hudson, New York. His large-scale site-specific installations have been exhibited nationally at institutions such as the Cornell Museum of Art and American Culture, the Moxie Museum of Exploration and Innovation. He has also had solo shows at Nonfinito Gallery, On Canal, and Lightbox. Primarily working with string and light, his work crosses numerous disciplines. From architecture and digital media to sculpture, Fisher has pushed the boundaries of the way string and light can be used and transformed to create distinct forms, structures, and environments. Through the combination of string and digital projections, the work finds a unique aesthetic balance between organic and synthetic. So please help me welcoming Jacob Fisher.
Hi, thank you. Thank you, Han. I'm gonna just change this photo so I don't have to like look at myself. So, thank you, Han, for that introduction, and thank you, Chadney and Wesley and the rest of the Meow Wolf team, for bringing this all together and finally being able to create a work at Meow Wolf, which has been so exciting. Considering most of you haven't seen, let me move this a little, seen the piece I've created at Meow Wolf because I finished it about an hour ago. It didn't feel that relevant to talk about it specifically, but hopefully sharing some insight and background about myself and about my process and what guides my work will help give you some context to what I do, and if and when you do see it, hopefully it makes a little more sense. My hope is that in sharing these insights, I can convey a little bit more of what my work means and the intentions behind it, which is hard because I intentionally try not to assign a direct narrative to the work, partly because I'm not great with words and partly because I see it as limiting in the sense that I'm a pretty firm believer that once I say something what something is supposed to mean, the viewer is limited to looking and experiencing the work through that lens. I'm going to move this so I can see what I'm actually trying to project here. Sorry. Okay, there, that maybe is a little better. I'm just gonna click through images of my work, and hopefully it gives you some sort of sense of what I do. So, the intent is that the ambiguity in the work and the titles of the work allow each viewer to have their own personal and unique experience from it. Whether the piece feels peaceful, tranquil, chaotic, It looks like an explosion in a string factory, or even, you know, it just outright sucks. My intent is that the viewer creates their own unique opinion and experience for each installation that I create. And because my work is so often creating immersive environments, it's important to me that no one feels wrong, and that there's no right answer, and that there's nothing wrong with having an opinion or feeling that differs from what the artist intended. So to give you some background, I went to Bard College and studied studio art there, and a lot of my classmates were making work that was hyper-intellectual, based a lot in theory and concept, and it was the sort of artwork that kind of left you with this feeling that there was some sort of book you didn't read. But I had a professor at Bard named Judy Pfaff, and if you're not familiar with her work, she's really a true pioneer of installation art. And during my time at Bard, Judy was not only a professor and an advisor to me, but a mentor in the truest sense of the word. And I believe one of like the most impactful concepts that she instilled into me is that there can be intelligence in the work that isn't verbal. And this seems obvious, but in a lot of ways it's not in the art world today. It's about understanding that there's a language and a vocabulary that exists, and that is only really understand visually. The way we think about, I think, things conventionally is that intellect is judged through things like reading, understanding scientific theories, mathematic equations, but there's like this visual knowledge that in a lot of ways, I think, isn't regarded in the same way. And what made me understand this concept is something that Judy once said to me quite bluntly. She said, "You're not incredibly smart in a lot of ways, but you are very visually smart." And what I believe she meant by that is that I visually and spatially understand things really well, and that I need to embrace and accept that. And rather than attempting to pretend that I'm incredibly well-versed in philosophical texts or theories, I need to kind of just embrace what I possess. And this sentiment made a huge impact on me and how I continue to work. And I think a lot of times coming out of art school, people don't feel that they can go against that sort of traditional art world route, which is so overbearing in New York. But in a lot of ways, Judy gave me the permission, which then allowed me to feel like I could. And rather than starting from a literal box, which she would always say, you know, a canvas, which is traditionally where we're taught to make art within, she gave me permission to work outside of that box. And I needed it because I couldn't make a clean edge, like, to save my life. I mean, I couldn't make straight lines, you know. I would hang something up and it would fall off the ceiling, and then I would try to, like, burn it, and then, like, you know, it would turn into this complete, like, disaster. And, you know, I was trying to, like, keep up with these other students who were making this, like, really clean, cool, minimalist, modern work. And I was just like, okay, I can't do this at all. But I needed to embrace that and understand it. And I learned to embrace that messiness, I think. I learned to embrace that chaos and understanding that it's not wrong to make work like that, I think, was really important for me. And now I really want to want that experience for those who engage with the work. It meets you wherever you are, whatever your interpretation of it is, and whatever your experience of it is completely valid. A lot of my process is based in my studio where I fabricate these installations. And this part of the process is incredibly isolating. The repetitive nature of tying hundreds of thousands of pieces of string in and out for days and days on end, to some may seem like torture, but the funny part about it for me, it becomes incredibly meditative and cathartic. I'm always like moving. Oh, sorry. That's like a perfect place for me to say moving. And doing and having trouble staying focused on, you know, one thing. But when I'm in the studio creating this work, it feels as if time stops. And it's the closest thing I think I can get to meditation. But for me, doing this repetitive process for hours on end allows me to feel this sort of tranquility that I assume and I expect one feels when they do meditate. But the other part of my process that is so fundamental to my work is the space and the environments that I create the work in. I become so intrigued by the unique elements of a space and the environment that I'm working in. That just happens to be kind of a good photo to pair. I guess on the left side was the hallway prior to me doing an installation, and the right side's with the installation. That being said, it's not just the space itself. It's the history of the space. It's the story of the space. It often feels like that there's these hidden messages within the space that I attempt to discover, and they can happen, and you can discover them when you're standing on a ladder for 30 minutes and, you know, you see the change in reflection of the light and the shadows it creates from a new vantage point, or it happens when you're sweeping the floor and the movement of the broom generates a breeze through the work that you just haven't seen. So for me, the internal dialogue happens in the studio, whereas the external dialogue happens and is completely contingent on the space and the environment that I'm working within. And I think that there's such an intricate connection between the space you're working in and the work itself. It yields this sort of new way of seeing to me. So I think that one thing I attempt to achieve with my work is having viewers try to see a little more, to feel a little more, maybe in a new or unexpected environment, leaving things up to the whim of the space itself, and leaving meaning to be ambiguous can also leave me wondering about what kind of impact the work is able to have on others and what I'm putting into the world. Which I hope allows people to find beauty amid all of this chaos and ugliness that we have in the world. So lastly, to kind of share a personal story, both of my parents are doctors, and as much as I wanted to follow in their footsteps, and I would have loved to go into the field of medicine, it certainly wasn't in the cards for me, especially if you saw how I did in high school math and science. But I just recently did teach myself the Pythagorean theorem, which I'm incredibly excited about, especially for this piece right here. It was very crucial. But I do, however, struggle sometimes with the question of what am I doing this for, and is it really meaningful for people in the way that I want it to be? Whenever I hear or see my parents treating sick patients, I contemplate whether I'll ever be able to create that sort of effect on someone else or in someone in need. So about 4 years ago, I had an installation up on 14th Street in Manhattan. These are just some more images not related to that, but similar to the one that I've created at Meow Wolf. And on one of the final nights of the exhibition, was open, the Parkland shooting in Florida occurred. And that evening, a woman came into the exhibition. She was looking incredibly distressed and spent close to an hour in the exhibit. And while she was leaving, she came up to a group of us who had been sitting at the front desk and explained how upset she was about how unfair and unjust the world felt that day. She told us she had been wandering around the city for the past few hours because she didn't know what to do with herself. And she told us that she saw the sign on the door for this exhibition, decided to come in. And after spending close to an hour in the exhibit, she explained that experiencing this show and allowing herself to become lost within the work that was created, it made her feel as though things were going to be okay for her and be okay in the world. So a lot of times people ask me what inspires my work, and the answer is always stories like that. So thank you. And then some more images. That's Meow Wolf.
What did you do with this, Jacob? Okay, can you all hear me? Yes, as with all of these, it's great because you're really only getting a small taste, even though they're showing you so much. A big component of Jacob's work, it really is the way that the light moves through it, and you get that meditative quality with the projection mapping that he does with these pieces. So highly encourage everybody to check out all of these when they're open, and spend some time, and then maybe write an email to Jacob. Thank you so much. So the final artist, who really needs no introduction, but I'm going to introduce anyway, Virgil Ortiz is one of the most avant-garde artists of his time. With a career spanning four decades, Ortiz's artistry extends across various media and boundaries, challenging societal expectations and breaking taboos. His vision fuses his Pueblo culture with sci-fi, fantasy, and apocalyptic themes, yielding imagery that is both provocative and futuristic. Ortiz's works are exhibited in museum collections worldwide, including Fondation Cartier, I practiced saying that, Smithsonian Institution, I didn't practice that one. Institution, Minneapolis Institute of Art, Peabody Essex Museum, oh my gosh, sorry, and the Denver Art Museum. Please help me in welcoming Virgil Ortiz.
Now I'm not gonna feel bad when I get my tongue twisted too. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming, and Han, we've been friends for a while, and thank you for giving us all the opportunity to show what we've got coming, and thank you, Chadney and Wesley, for walking us through and walking us off the bridge sometimes, too. But, okay, cool. I'll give you a quick background of, do I just push the forward button?
Yeah, sorry.
It's all good. All right. Does it sound better now? Okay, cool. I'm Virgil Ortiz, and I come from Cochiti Pueblo, right down the road. And I feel there are two reasons here that I'm on this earth to do, is to make sure that our Cochiti Pueblo pottery, the traditional works, don't die out, and also to educate globally about the 1680 Pueblo Revolt, which, do you guys know what that is? Most people here, they do. That's amazing. Usually, like, nobody knows what it is, and that's just like when the invaders came to our area and took over all of our land, and the whole story of like how the genocide started happening, and how all the Pueblos got together and pulled off the first American Revolution. So what I'm doing is to use the art to tell that whole story. So some of these images are all based on a screen that I've written about the Pueblo Revolt, and it takes place happening in 1680 and also in 2180, two different time dimensions, and that allows me to go back to when I was a kid, that I really love sci-fi movies and Star Wars, Star Trek, Battlestar Galactica, all that, very heavily influenced by sci-fi movies. And so I've written that movie script, and that allowed me to bring in a lot of sci-fi storytelling aspect to it. So I created 19 groups of characters that represent the 19 pueblos that are left in New Mexico today. So that's what you'll be seeing through this whole presentation. I was born into a family of potters on my mother, Seferina Ortiz, side of the family. So all of my grandmothers, aunts, everybody were all potters. So growing up, we had worked with clay every day on our kitchen table. Our mom would be working. And it was, I had no idea that it was art being created on a daily basis. Like every time I get home from school, like I'd start playing with clay. And I had no idea until like all the different gallery openings started happening with my parents and tagging along with them. But these are some of the, our parents, both are now gone. Our mom passed in 2007, our dad in 2015. These are some of the family members that are still making the traditional Pueblo pottery. When I say tradition, it means that we go dig our own clay and we make everything from the earth itself. So these are samples of all the collections and the materials that we use. So we gather all the clay from Cochiti Pueblo. We go hand dig it, and it's like a year-long process that it takes to get these materials together, because when the clay comes out of the earth, it's still very damp and very pure. So we have to dry it out for a whole year, because if you're to try to soak it and work with it, it's too pure and it won't dissolve a lot. So we have to dry it out and then crack it up and then rehydrate it evenly. So that allows us to work with the clay. We gather another type of material called the pumice stone, which is the white sand on the bottom left-hand side. And we gather all these materials with the family because it's a tedious project to do it by yourself. So my whole family helps us to get these materials. The traditional colors are black, white, and red from Cochiti, and the black paint is made from wild spinach. So that's a sample. Like when the purple flowers bloom on the wild spinach plant, we got to go gather the whole family and pick it. And that's like another tedious thing to do, is because like we're only after the leaves itself. So if we're all together, because we all share the materials that we get, and we usually pick about like 8 33-gallon size bags of the wild spinach, take it home, put it in large boiling pots of water, and usually like around the fifth day of boiling, then it starts to dissolve. We strain it, and what we're doing is just we're after the juice. So strain out the leaves. And after we had like so many pots of boiling water, it boils down to like half a gallon. And then I'm able to take it inside and then continue boiling it there. And if you overboil it at this point, it really sucks because it doesn't stick to the pottery. So you've wasted like 2 weeks of trying to make the black paint. But once you got all these materials ready to go, then like we always prepare for the next year. So it's a long process to use these traditional materials, and that's why it's a dying art form. And what Cochiti is known for is it's all based on social commentary. So there's a picture from Ben Wittick from the late 1800s, and all of these really cool characters came from like all the newly laid railroads that were in the area. So when the train started coming, it brought more people, more tourists, and with that brought more entertainment. So you see samples of characters that were made out of clay that resembled like opera shows or circuses, sideshows here. So what I did was I wanted to that style of social commentary was lost at Cochiti. So I really wanted to bring it back and revive this type of storytelling. So on the right-hand side, I asked all my family members to pick one of their favorite pieces from the 1800s and recreate it. So we pulled that off. And now these pieces reside at Foundation Cartier in the permanent exhibition. So taking that whole storytelling of social commentary, right? Now it leaves the door wide open for me to talk about any subject. So the LGBTQ community, this piece is called Hate is a Drag. So you can just really use all these different subject matter. And this is a sample of one of the traditional works, the pots that I learned how to paint when I was a kid. So all of the designs that we use are all earth elements. So it's like the wild spinach, the clouds, the rain, the snow, the kiva steps, the wild spinach paint, the plant on the bottom. But I really started to figure out that I could use the characters that I was creating and combine them with the ceramics, what I'm known for, and really take advantage of what I could tell as storytelling. So it goes down to politics as well, and this one's called Rise Up, and it's one pot, and it's being showed right now at the Museum of Indian Arts and Culture on the Museum Hill here. Being traveling around when I was in my teen years and going to the underground clubs, so I was again just using exactly what I seen, recording it, and then putting them onto pots and, like, you know, bringing all the stories back to my family. Then it's started really getting interested in fashion. So now that you know, a lot of the magazines that we looked at, I couldn't afford any of the clothes, but I was like, cool, we could make it ourselves. So I started taking a lot of the different design elements from pottery and then placing them onto the different leather accessories, the clothing, and then got really into really finalizing and kind of making all of the character development a little bit more final. And then I taught myself how to use Photoshop, so it came in handy to really start combining all these different types of media that I do work in. And here's the Pueblo Revolt again, is like how to educate the world about what happened to our people, what will capture the next generation's attention. It's like, oh, yeah, cool, movie script. So this is what you see, like, with the futurism and all of the different characters that I do create. Samples of when we're at my house doing body painting and really developing the characters as fully as I can. More samples. A lot of these guys are friends and family and also students that I work with at different universities when I go do workshops. This was actually a hand from the Colorado College. the middle figure is a old a billboard. So it's a recycled material. Like, after my show had came down, I asked for the material, then turned it into some more art. And again, using different types of imagery and trying to make it more appealing to the next generation to get their attention and then guide them into not knowing they're learning a lesson in history. And then knock, 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 here comes Meow Wolf. So I was like, okay, and I'm used to, like, working with clay and painting and jewelry and fashion and stuff that you would go to, like, in a gallery or a museum exhibition, and you can't touch any of these. Like, they're behind vitrines, right? So once I was approached to do a Meow Wolf, they're like, okay, it has to be interactive. Yes, you let the whole public touch everything and interact with it. So I was like, oh my God, I've never, that was like a huge challenge. I don't know if you guys felt that as well, like to be able to have people climbing on it or selfies or whatever, having fun with it. So this were samples when I worked up at Archie Bray Foundation up in Helena, Montana. So I was developing these characters called the Recon Watchmen. And the Recon Watchmen, I designed them. So they're us in the future from 2180. So they're coming back to historic times and present time and what they're doing. And they're collecting all of our songs, our designs, our ways of life, our ceremonies, taking them to 2180, storing them or protecting them so that when we get to 2180, all of our traditions and our language and songs are still intact. Going big, I've never worked this large in clay before. So, like, Han, like you're saying, like all of the artists that you have the opportunity to go big, you need help to do it. And my problem was, like, being was just working by myself all the time. So to bring in my friends to help me do that was, like, really cool to be able to go bigger and using all the resources, like really huge kilns and all. And all of these new pieces that, like, are all ceramic, they're intended to be shown at the new Vladim Contemporary Museum when it opens here. So I think that's probably in the springtime. Some more samples of the carving. And so when I wanted to design this this exhibition at Meow Wolf, I was like, okay, I'm going to really feature the sirens. Sirens are protectors and guardians and bodyguards of children. And they're also making the armor for these Recon Watchmen characters. So you'll see these two characters featured in the exhibition at Meow Wolf. So my team here, there's Chris Casey, Alex Matthews, and Daniel Kosaus. These are some of my friends from Albuquerque. So we got together, got all the different models, took plaster forms of their faces so we could have each individual face print to make their masks. And then we covered them once we had a positive in a form of their face, then we use monster clay, which is oil clay, to cover the piece and really develop that character and start carving it and kind of make it look like the clay pieces that I work in. And I've never worked with mold before, mold. You shouldn't work with mold. But all of those different types of mold making with silicone and latex and all that. But it's really awesome to work, have a team to work on a project like this. So on the bottom right was the final design of the Recon Watchman. So once we had all the costuming done, foam fabrication, metal, wood, all of the different types of synthetic material for their faces and their masks, I wanted to bring the Recon Watchman to life. So the perfect background was the Bisti Badlands, which is in northern New Mexico. And some of like the other characters, the Aeronauts, we filmed them down in White Sands. So that was kind of like where they lived. But now the Recon Watchman, have you guys been there? It's like amazing to see. It looks like you're on another planet, but that was a perfect background for them. So these are who is being featured in the exhibition. And you'll see like a floor to ceiling sculpt of the Recon Watchman bust. One side will have completely graphics of that was taken from our traditional pottery designs. In the middle of the room, you'll have a pedestal that has the different masks at different stages, how we're building them. So it has two-way mirrors in it, so you could walk around it and it just reflects infinity. So you'll be able to see that. And then a whole wall that is with video footage, and some of the video footage we have right now, you could see. That's it. Cool.
Yay! it just made me beam to see all of that, even though I've known about these projects, but I'm still seeing new elements of them all the time. So I hope you all feel really inspired to go see them. We're just going to take a moment to move the podium off the stage, and then we'll have just a short conversation really with the artists, and then open it up for audience questions. So please stick around, and thank you all so much. Yeah.
All right, thank you all so much for being here with us. This is amazing, and what a great turnout. So cool to see so many awesome human beings. Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone. That was an incredible introduction. I'm going to now not do nearly as well as you did. But also, I'm going to start actually where we left off. I would love to hear more about the intersection, Virgil, between you working, you know, so kind of consciously to keep these traditional forms alive that your family and ancestors have had for so many generations. The subject matter that you put on your work that is so contemporary and so now, and then the futurism that your work captures, and so how your work takes place basically throughout time and what that means for your work and how the future relates to historical elements, et cetera.
Well, most people don't know about the social commentary pieces from the late 1800s, and they're kind of timeless because they're black and white and red. So just to be able to learn about these pieces through one of our collectors, our family collectors named Robert Gallegos out of Albuquerque, he would come to our home when he knew me since I was like 6 years old. So he was the first person to expose my family to the pieces from the 1800s, because most people were creating storytellers from Cochiti Pueblo, so nobody knew about these pieces. But when I was about 15, he was asking my parents, like, who's teaching this kid how to do these types of figures and like comment on stuff? And they took me down. He said, please bring him down to the showroom in Albuquerque. Went down there for the first time, and we walked in, and my parents and I flipped out because when it turned out that he had the largest collection of these historic figurative pottery. So it was like at that point, like my parents knew. They took me outside and they said, remember this day, because like this clay is choosing you. We didn't teach you any of this. So remember this day and like, you know, just remember it. So at that age, I knew I was going to dedicate my life to clay and to revive it. But the only way that I could figure out how to reach the next generation and get their attention, hopefully inspire them, was through futurism. And that's how I'm connecting those two different types of, you know, history and also futurism and also the present.
Thank you.
Yeah, and Lauren, I mean, your work is so related in that way, of course. I loved all the references to the protector of the queer, the queen of femme, what was the other one? Gender fluid, deity of compassion, governing this space. Did you always do that, pulling in these characters? And you've kind of ended up in a, it's so similar but so different from what Virgil is doing. How do you consider yourself in that futurism category?
Yeah, totally. Hell yeah, Virgil. I'm so into it. Yeah, I think, you know, when I started out, my visual, like, Rolodex was very much just futurist, like, space. My little sister worked at NASA. My dad was a pilot. It was very, like, space-oriented. And I didn't have that much connection to my Asian roots. And I think it's just getting a little bit older and over the years and being involved in social justice and politics and being, like, taking an interest in my heritage, which I didn't always as a kid. When you're, I don't know, I think it's a common immigrant experience to be like, oh, it's lame to be like really Asian. When you're a kid, you just want to be like American, you know? But as I've gotten older, I've found how beautiful and lush and amazing Chinese culture is. So I started trying to like mold it together with what I was doing with futurism. And I think like if you do enough research and digging into like, you know, Asian American history and mythology, there's so much cool stuff in there. I never knew it, but like finding that there's a protector of the queer is so cool. And so I'm really grateful for the past few years. It's been dark times, but like having a real passion for where you come from as an adult is such a gift, because it, you know, it's sad to grow up being like trying to push it away. But yeah, it's so fun to create new landscapes of like trying to like, you know, get people who are not that into that culture and like turn them on to it by making it like psychedelic and glowing and like new and fresh.
Yeah, and maybe the next generation of folks will grow up thinking that both of those things that you all are doing is just inherently cool, for lack of a better word.
Yeah.
But in trying to influence that younger generation of people to be interested. And given that we're just so narrative, you know, dense and heavy in our storytelling, Jacob, I'm interested in like having your work in such a deeply narrative context actually did change it for you? Like, did it influence it, or does it still feel abstract to you, or does it feel like it's creating a planet because of where it is now?
I think that like there is a narrative, you know, there is a story, I think, behind all of the work. It's something that I think until more recently I've been nervous to share and kind of like get into. You know, I don't, it's places like, you know, that for, I was thinking about it the other day where I was, it was like I at first I created the work to kind of escape this, whatever that story was. And now I think I'm starting to try to embrace that narrative. And I just recently did a show at a gallery in New York that was like very much where I told a story and I like told the narrative. And, you know, I was very hesitant to do it, but the director of the gallery was pretty adamant that like, okay, tell this story. And you know, I had dealt with a lot of medical issues as like a child. I was born with a bunch of like medical conditions where I needed 16 surgeries before the age of like 5 years old. And then kind of like how that's affected me throughout my kind of entire life and manifested into like mental health issues. And it was something that I never wanted to kind of touch on. And I think like as time went on, I think, you know, as I said before, doing the artwork, making the artwork was this really cathartic experience. So if I brought in, you know, this other part of it, it was like, I was high, you know, it was like, kind of like, okay, I don't have to deal with these issues. And now I'm trying to kind of put them a little bit more out there because I think that if I do, my intent, I hope, is that it can help other people and, you know, we can, you know, start having a more serious conversation about some of this stuff. So I think that there is this important narrative to the work that I'm trying to kind of constantly battle, where it's like, show too much, show too little, but also like I was saying, I want people to have their own interpretation and I want them to take something from it that's personal to themselves when I create work. So I get nervous about creating too much of a narrative.
That's amazing. Thank you, Jacob. Lauren, I have a question for you. In our process, and this is totally like a question that comes from the process of us working together and understanding that you've actually pushed your process forward. Like you're doing sculptural art that you hadn't really done before and kind of pushing like the ways that you're expressing yourself forward in form. And I'd love for you to talk a little bit about that and like how this process has, you know, like what you found during that, this process of creating these sculptural elements, large scale, et cetera. Now like mechanized pieces, et cetera. We learned about Pepper's ghosts. Like, yeah, please.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Pepper's ghost. Like it was a massive undertaking to be like, okay, I have a 3D room and all of the senses to approach and how do I completely envelop the viewer into like this feeling of a world. And it was a real challenge for me because I'm so like 2D color focused to even wrap my head around how I would like get people to feel what I wanted them to feel. And then it's also just difficult to think about the third dimension. I'd be like, oh, there's like, this takes so much longer to paint because there's like backside to things and other angles. And like, and it was really meticulous work. And that's why I'm so happy I had a team of people who are like much, like I learned so many skills from these girls that I've been working with. They're incredible artisans and artists. And like really sort of handheld me through a bunch of panic attacks and like freakouts. And it was just like a really powerful, like collaborative way to approach things. And I think it was really beautiful to have the opportunity to reach out to collaborate with other artists too, to like, you know, we're talking about the soundscape that's going to be in the room. And I have a friend who's non-binary, a Japanese artist who played an album for me like 8 months ago. And then I thought about it and was like, oh, that's what the room sounds like. So it's also a great way to talk about community and the collective with being in a queer space or being in an Asian American space, where it's not just all my work. And I think I love working on the mechanized pieces because it allows me to do like visual storytelling in a way that actually moves and flows. Because with murals, we're always talking about trying to create like a flow in a static image. And so when I can literally have it moving, it's this like beautiful way of being able to tell story and imply narrative without just having like, you know, because even though murals are amazing, like you kind of look at it and you move on. And that's something that I feel like kind of heartbroken about sometimes. So getting to move into like all these different dimensions is such a dream come true. So I'm so grateful.
And Virgil, for you as well, there's more new media elements to your space than I've ever seen you work with before. I'd love to hear about your experience with that. A lot of the video images that you all were seeing are going to be on screens in the room, and then there's interactive elements and lighting and the large sculptures. It's probably hard for the audience to even imagine what it's going to be like, given how much content is in there.
Talk about panic attacks. I've never worked with foam before. So like having, picking up the foam from the foam store, if you call it that, like fit on the back of my truck is like 4x8 blocks of foam. And I was like, can I really drive like on the highway with this? And we get it to my friend Chris's studio. Like it was just funny because they're like 300 pounds each. We took it off and then we project it onto it. And then we traced the image that we wanted to carve out of it, and we've used hot wire tools, which we never used before. And we're just, I mean, it's so good to have a team that we're all just depending on each other to figure it out. And at certain times, we're like over many drinks and trying to troubleshoot, right? It was pretty cool because it slowly started to take space. I mean, take an image, I mean, come to life. Mm-hmm. And at a certain point, like, we're like, oh my God, this is taking forever. I can't do this. But we just kept pushing each other's, and to have that, you know, that experience with the foam and to see how it's coming out is like really badass to see it when you walk into a room, because the room is small, but to have a bus that big, a recon watchman looking at you is like overwhelmed when you see it. So anybody that came to the studio to see it, they're pretty blown away from the size of it. It's pretty fun.
Jacob, I'm watching your piece develop over the last several days. I know that most of your process is happening in your studio alone. I mean, you've been spending months preparing for this, and then you have days to like assemble it all. Watching it come together over the last several days, it's like revealed itself to me in a way. And what it's revealed to me personally is it's making me think about how I see. Like, your work is so reductive and deceptively simple, but there has dimension to it. And depth, and the light that allows us to see it is so intentional. I would love for you to talk more about that process, because the way you play with dimension and light in your forms feels so incredibly intentional, and like every portion of it like works so well in this space. And so clearly you're like, as you said, connecting with the space and seeing how the space informs your work. Could you talk further about all that?
Yeah, I think like one of the first days when you came into the space, I said to you, oh yeah, the conversation the space and I had last night, you know, like, I was like, it wants to do this. And you were like, oh, okay, what is it? Maybe you should go to bed or stop drinking something. I don't know. I think, you know, a lot of, I think what was instilled in me from Judy, who was the mentor who I mentioned earlier, was trial and error. And I think that, you know, it's a lot of putting stuff up and taking stuff down and putting stuff up and taking stuff down. And what was actually really nice about this project, which was only 4 days, so it was a really short, intense amount of time, was that I didn't get the extra time to start second guessing myself. So it was like, the first thing I put up is the thing that I'm going with, because there's just not time to mess around, because by like the sixth or seventh day, usually on an install, it's like the entire piece comes down, and my like manager comes into the space the next day and he's like, what happened to the entire work? And like the gallerist comes, why is there no work up anymore? I'm like, no, it wasn't working, you know. So it's like, it's so much trial and error, and it's like listening to the space, I think, and for me. And I think like that's where I find so much of the influence, I think, in the work. And it's kind of like you see something and it evolves and it makes sense, and it's like, okay, this works, like, let's keep going with this. Or it doesn't work, and it's like, let's take this down. And I think you probably saw, you know, today I moved around a few different components just because it didn't feel like right for whatever reason. And it's one of those things where it's like, you know, these coincidences that occur where it's like, okay, that works, that doesn't work. I mean, the way I stumbled upon projection mapping is this, I'll tell this very quick story, is like, I was working primarily with string, And I went to Japan and I saw this exhibition with all of these, it was by Team Labs. They had like 15 projections in the room. And I was like, oh my God, I'm like in this foreign country, you know, a language I don't know, like in this completely crazy like environment that like I feel so unfamiliar with, yet I feel so comfortable. And I was like, how can I create that? So the second I get back to New York, I buy a projector. And I'm like working in this little office space. I just so happened to like shine the projector through the string. I was thinking like there were two different things, and like the projections hit the string, and I was like, okay, like that's it. Like, oh my God, you know, it was like one of those like things that just clicked. And I think like from there, it's just building on that. It's like something works, okay, go with it. If it doesn't work, forget it.
Thank you.
Yeah. So part of the way that we ask artists to propose for projects is we ask them to do a written description of whatever their project is going to be. And I was really interested in one of the things that you wrote, Lauren, in your description of the space, Ancestral Crypt, which was between yin and yang, body and soul, life and death, male and female, and that this space was going to be a liminal space exploring those things. And I would just love for you to talk about, I just thought that was a really striking statement to really compare connecting life and death and gender identity with this work. So I'd love for you to just talk about that and how you tried to visually translate that for folks.
Sure. I spend a lot of time thinking about paradoxes. And especially during the making of this process, like I went through a difficult time during the making of this installation. And I spent a lot of time thinking about how desperately I wanted to be in the future, where it was like installed, and then thinking about the past and the things I was going through, and realized that so much of being an adult and, you know, being in difficult like processes of change is that you're always going to be in the middle moment. Like whether you like it or not, you're always in a liminal space. You're always in a process of either healing or growing or trying to get to like the end of your process. But if you don't spend the time looking at what you're making in front of you, then you're going to miss it. And I thought it was interesting, like I was using all these things from the past and trying to translate them into like this imagined future, and being like, God, I wish it was somewhere else, somewhere less hot, not LA or whatever. And just being like, no, focus on what you're doing. This is your life. This is also like, you know, and sorry to get off track here, but I think so many of us are going through really rough things. It was particularly rough for like everyone around me when I was making this installation, and it's been a rough few years. So it was like a lot of meditation on focusing on like what it means to be present and accept that you might be going through something really messed up, and that's just what it is to be like a person. And also that's what the ancestors went through, and like subsuming the kind of trauma and difficulties that they went through and feeling them in your body. And trying to create a space for people who are like, instead of a space where you're running away from those things, a space where you can be there and feel it and accept that that's what it means to be a human person. And a lot of it is just holding in the center of this like swinging back and forth and being like, what, you know, what gender do I feel like today? And having an expansive sense of that and being comfortable with the discomfort rather than wanting to run away from it. And so I sort of imagine this space is like somewhere floating in between, you know, like the Edo period in Japan was called the floating world. Sort of trying to capture that fleeting idea of like a space that's like somewhere between, it's, you don't know if you're dead, you don't know if you're like, you know, afterwards or before, or a child or an old person. You don't know if you're, you know, Asian today or American, then, you know, today. One of the nicest things about the room is that there's four entrances, and this is a room that you naturally pass through, which I also like. It's very liminal in a way, but you can spend time in there. But the entrance from the forest already had like a raised step. And I was like, this is perfect, because when I visited my grandma's village in China when I was a kid, all the doorways have a raised step. And she told me it was because demons can't jump. And I was like, perfect, this is already like that. The room is already like sort of a temple, like a liminal space, a space where you go to connect with spaces that you can't see. And so that's what I was trying to reach towards. Good question.
That was really beautiful. Thank you. I'm glad we're recording this so I can listen to that later.
Virgil, I have a question for you. Looking at a lot of the pieces that you showed us today, Clearly, sexuality and fashion play a big role in a lot of the work that you do. And I'd love for you to talk a little further about that, like how you're kind of, you know, incorporating sexuality and what your kind of what your goal is in doing that in your work, and then that, how that translates into the fashion work you do as well.
Well, it's not for shock value, but it's like just, again, going back to the historic pieces, they created a bunch of like interactions like for prostitution that went on. So like all of the people that see these kind of pieces, like, oh, he's doing it for shock value, but it's not. And it's just going, following what our ancestors did before us. And if you really want to get shocked, you could see some of the historic pieces and how they portrayed reality. And like, you know, they wrote everything down on the pieces in Spanish. So they're talking about the transactions of prostitution, what they're going to do. And like, that blows people's minds. Like my work is, I think, is lame compared to our ancestors. So, and it's pretty cool. Like, nobody knows.
That's not true.
And nobody knows about these pieces, right? So it's like, I want to be a part of that, whether it be like ancestral memory or something, like what's instilled in me. Like, nobody taught me that. So I, you know, that's what I feel like I have to do and just continue it. So whatever that opens the door, I think I mentioned that earlier, opens the door really wide to a different subject matter, but it'll fall within the traditional work of our historic Cochiti figurative pottery.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I think I'll do a last question for Jacob, and then we'll be ready for audience Q&A. If you all have, I mean, we've asked every possible question in the world, so I don't know what you'd have, but Jacob, typically your work is like in the pop-up setting in a pretty temporal environment. And I think there's a nice thing that happens with capturing that, but then not being able to come back to it and revisit it, especially with like the meditative quality of it. Do you feel like it changes the context to be in this permanent installation, or does it do something different for you?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I think that when you traditionally think about installation art, I mean, it's kind of constantly thought of as temporal. You know, there's not many spaces where installations exist permanently. I mean, outside of if you're some sort of incredibly established artist and a museum buys your work and they put it up there, you know, but I think a lot of installation art is temporary. And, you know, when I first started doing installation, every single person in the art world said to me, good luck. And I was like, okay, they're like, no one's going to buy this. I'm like, okay, yeah, they're like, try to make a career. So, you know, it's always been this thing of like, okay, it is temporary, and there was something like that I loved about how ephemeral that was, but having something that's permanent in a sense, you know, is interesting too. I mean, I think that like it just allows more people to see it. I don't know how long it's going to exist. I don't know when Meow Wolf is planning to take it down. You know, maybe if everyone hates it, they're like, all right, let's get rid of this piece, put up something else. But, you know, I mean, I'm kind of, even with this piece, I think I'm thinking that it is temporary. Like everything in life is fleeting. So I think it, you know, it hasn't changed necessarily that much, even though maybe that's not the most exciting answer. But, you know, it's kind of that it's all part of this evolving process. And everything's temporary in the grand scheme of things, I don't know, without getting too existential. So I think, you know, it's just, it's that. I don't know if that answers the question, but yeah, that's...
Thank you. Do we have audience questions? We have a mic set up over here if anybody has something that they want to ask, or I could bring my mic to you. And I can also barely see you, so I'm going to do this.
Catherine has a mic right here, though.
Okay, great. Yes, I see you have a question. Can I bring this to you?
Nope. There's one coming. Oh, never mind.
From me.
Thank you so much to all of you for just what you do in the world. My name is Hillary. I'm a choreographer and dancer. Moved here from the Bay Area. Grew up in Tusuke, actually. So knew about the revolt growing up. I'm just curious about, maybe this is too much of a metaphysical question or something, but just curious about how artists are thinking of themselves now in the world with having come from the Bay Area where a lot of people were calling themselves creatives and felt that was very frustrating from an artist's perspective. Personally, just kind of living as an artist in the world these days, I'm just curious how you're thinking about yourself in the context of everything sort of outside of your work, or if you do, and yeah, I don't know if that question makes sense, but how it is to be an artist for you in the grand scheme of things.
I think it's difficult because that's a really good question, I think. And I think we are in a space where I think it's our duty to sort of reconfigure and redefine that, because going back to normal, I feel like is something we all want to do, but there's a reason everything's falling apart all the time, right? It's because it's like, you can't go back to normal. Everything's different now. And I think for me, I struggle to call myself an activist because I think it really, if you want to talk about social justice, like it's really easy for your head to get really big, really fast, and then you get in trouble. You got to do your research and be able to like uphold what you're talking about. But I did feel this really strong onus to talk about what was happening, at least for Asian Americans at this time. And, you know, my girlfriend and I were already protesting because there was no work. So every week we would be out with BLM in the streets of LA and like just listening and learning. And I had never really protested before. And it was really like, even though the world was shut down, it was a beautiful way to like open your ears and put down roots and be part of the community. And for someone who does so much public art, for me, I did feel like there was a huge responsibility for me to use the physical space that I have to talk about something. And to do my research and make sure that I was doing it to the best of my ability, because not that many people have a platform like me. Like, I have literal, like, space in the world. And it's not that common in the street art world for there to be someone like me given opportunities to take up space. It's a very, white male-dominated world, just like everything else. And so for me, it was like, if I continue to just do, make things that are pretty, I'm probably not doing the most I could be doing right now with the space that I have. And especially because, like, so much of street art, like, Asian femmes are traditionally represented as sort of, like, vapid, like, design elements when white men paint them. And that's a problem I have with street art in general. So I was like, I'm just going to recontextualize this, take this, and, like, tell stories about, like, aggressive, like, femme personalities and narratives and selfhood. And it's really scary to take on that kind of responsibility, but I've been given a lot of chances and I'm very appreciative for that of that. So I think I've seen a lot of people take on a lot more responsibility in past years, and I think it's really powerful to just like get educated and try to like always learn more and teach other people things that are like trying educating other people while I'm getting educated is something that I really really enjoy. Yeah, I don't know.
Do you want to go for it? I can say something. Yeah, it is funny with like calling yourself an artist. I'm like constantly struggling with that. I think, as you said, like it just feels like this like weird term now, especially with like this rise of everyone's a creative and to me, it just seems like it's I don't know how to think of it. Almost, it's just like I try to create what I'm attempting to create, and I want it to be impactful and meaningful, and however that's sort of classified, I think it's kind of like you want to stay true to, I think probably both of you guys agree with that, like what your idea is, what your vision is, what you want to put out into the world, and I think like whatever the classification of that is, it is what it is, and it's like just kind of stay true to that path or that idea of what you're trying to fulfill for yourself. And I think that's the most important thing to me.
Art is therapy, right? Our art is education. And I accepted that when I was like 15 years old, because I knew it wasn't about me. It was way bigger than me. And to be able to be a part of Coach Judy Pueblo and make sure that tradition stays alive, and also to tell our history, is very important to me. Call it what you want, call me what you want, as long as you call me. So it's just all works. Like, I don't know if we're chosen or something to do it, or like, I don't know what happens, but it's just kind of it just comes out naturally. And like, you know, I know I'm just like a bead in a necklace, and it's not me. Like, it takes a lot of people to make sure that it stays alive and intact, and our songs, our ceremonies, our ways of life as an indigenous person. And art is like as important as our language. So it says a lot as well as our language does. So, I mean, I'm just blessed to be born into Kochiti, and especially into a family of clay creatives.
Any more questions while I'm roaming? Yes, I see you, and then I'll come back.
First of all, thank you, all of you, for creating your work and sharing it and talking about it. I know it can be a very vulnerable thing to like make a piece of art and then have to talk about it instead of just let the art do its thing. But I appreciate getting to hear more about your stories. And I'm curious specifically the work, Virgil and Lauren, that you guys are doing, and this whole place of working in a sci-fi kind of futurism context from a non-white lineage and context, and not necessarily, you know, cis heteronormative white male voice. And in some ways it makes a lot of sense because the themes of sci-fi are so such apt metaphors for the experience of indigenous peoples, immigrants, enslaved peoples, these ideas of abduction and invaders and assimilation and all of this stuff. And I know that you both do a lot of very explicit work with connecting to ancestral imagery and themes and voices. And I'm curious if you feel a tension in regards to the kind of like sci-fi elements and so many of those coming from white male voices and imaginations and imagery, and if it's fun to kind of do like a culture jam with that, or if it feels inhibiting, like to kind of convey a sense of futurism, there has to, you know, be the voice of the traditional white male idea of what the future looks like. I don't know if that makes sense as a question, but I'm just curious where you find yourself kind of in the traditional tropes of sci-fi and then the specific context that you bring from your culture and your heritage.
Well, it's getting bigger and bigger in the movies, right? Like people of color coming into it was like superheroes and all that. Black Panther, for instance, and then now The Prey, which is the prequel to Predator. So, I mean, I was so affected as a kid when I seen Star Wars for the first time when I was like 6 or 7 years old. I learned exactly where they came from, what kind of ships they drove, how they dressed, how they talked. So that really resonated with me, and that was the easiest way for me to tell this story because I'm not an academic person at all. High school was the highest academic level that I went to, and everything else is just trial and error learning. But yeah, I think it's just... It's the easiest path that I can find to be able to connect and have everybody, the world, learn about our Pueblo life.
Totally. Also, you're very mysterious person in the hat. great question. I hadn't actually thought about the sci-fi element of my style because it doesn't come from a specific like one source. It actually mostly comes from like theory. Queer theory. I'm really obsessed with Donna Haraway and the Cyborg Manifesto. It's like something I wrote my thesis on in college. And it basically talks about how like feminist women and queer people are like robots in this very theoretical, weird way. And when you talk to like a lot of my friends who are like trans and non-binary, we talk about our bodies as being monstrous and like in a good way, like combined from lots of different parts. And it's like sometimes we're born into bodies that don't service as well as our identities do. And it's like this sort of really bizarre, like, embracing of being, like, imperfect and messed up and, like, like, this roiling, like, mass of different animal parts and, like, identities. And so that's why I do so many, like, weird centipede girls and, like, combination, like, hybrid chimerical creatures. And I think
Yeah, so it mostly comes from theory. And I don't like, I mean, I'm really obsessed with Mobius. So I think you're right. Sci-fi definitely does come from a lot of like sort of like cis white male like voices, but I hadn't really thought about where that specific visual influence came from. And I think a lot of the sci-fi stuff comes from, or like fantastical futuristic stuff comes from the Miyazaki's like science or like, I don't know, spacey elements that I grew up on. But that's a really smart question because I hadn't thought about that actually. But yeah, good question from mysterious person.
thank you, Tigre. Another couple of questions. I know, Ken, you have one. So we'll just do two more. Somebody's walking you, and then I'll go to Ken.
Hi. What's up? Virgil, I was actually just really interested in the clay process that you do with your family, and specifically in like the spinach that you're harvesting, and you were talking about like when you're boiling it, if you overboil it, like you have to like just do the whole thing again. And I was kind of just like wondering how long it took you to get that process down, or if it like if you would do it with your like family as an apprentice, or yeah, just like a little more about that process. Super interesting. Thank you.
Who knows how long our people have been doing it that way? They're like scientists, like, I mean, making paint out of wild spinach. how did that happen? But yeah, it, I mean, it takes like at least if we're doing a big batch, it takes us like 2 weeks to do. And it sucks if you, I try to take many shortcuts, like from our mom's teaching. Like she's like, only get the leaves, no stems, no nothing like that. And me trying to outsmart it, just cut up the whole thing. It didn't work, and I wasted that many times. But I don't know. It just like that's just what our people did. So I never question it. A lot of people ask like, what cone do you fire your pottery to? And I still don't know that either. I know there's parameters that you can use to test it, but I don't need to know that just because our people never did either. I don't know. It's just like and there's like. It blew my mind now working with high fire ceramics as well with kilns and different types of clay and the textures and all the, you could go to a store and everything's bagged. And that blew my mind. And I had no idea, like, wait, that takes us a whole year to get all these our clay and all. But now to be able to teach and go do workshops at different universities, different ceramic areas, I mean, workplaces, it's like, it opened up like so many new opportunities. So at each city, you could just go to the ceramic store and get those materials. But the heart and soul of everything that I do is a traditional work, and that I keep that at Cochiti.
Oh, when it comes to like making the actual art, how do you guys deal with like the time management and like the deadlines, and if like the brainstorming, then the sketching, then the actual making it. And how does that affect like your creative process?
We are the taskmasters. But that's not an answer.
I'm not sleeping for the past 5 days. No, I think like, you know, you have the initial part of the process, which takes, you know, with Han and Chadney and Wesley, where we're talking kind of concepts and ideas, and, you know, it's not just concepts, right? It's not just ideas, it's how it like functions in a space. And I think there's like a practicality to understanding all of that, which I think from art school, like you don't get that at all. You start seeing that, I think, once you're in the real world, that like there's fire codes, there's building codes, there's ways you need to suspend stuff from the ceiling, you know, and starting to kind of understand all of those and realize those limitations and then work within those boundaries. And I think that for me, a big part of it is being able to be adaptive, especially, and that comes back to the whole concept of the space, because I think once you're in the space and you have these limitations, I mean, the space I worked in at Meow Wolf has this massive HVAC unit coming through it and these different pipes running through, you know, it's this the craziest space I've ever worked in. And it's there's a massive, another artwork, a ball or a globe, a dome Dale's Ball is what it's called. And, you know, working around all these parameters, but still trying to find like what you're trying to accomplish is like a lot of, I think it's like compromise, but also like dealing with it and just being like, okay, like go with the punches and figure out like, let's make this as cool as we can and with these limitations. And I think it like disrupts the process a bit, but it also ultimately ends up like always creating something I think that's great.
Were you guys a control freak before this? I think it helped me like to working with a team and deadlines that helped me really stop being a control freak. I'm trying really hard not to be a control freak. But like, and having a team, you know, you have to put all your trust in your team, all the members, and just trust it and go for it. That's what it taught me.
Yeah, I have never worked with a team in this way before. And I learned that for many, first you have a mental breakdown for like 2 months and then you start on the project. it was great. And then you spend many months building all the little things and being like, there's nothing happening. And then in the course of a week with people who are really amazing, everything starts coming together. And for the first time you cry of relief instead of like anxiety. And I learned that this is the way like my roommates and the people I work with in my community do it, because they're builders. Like, they know what they're doing. I don't know what I'm doing. And so that was a great learning experience, to be like, the patience to build everything in little parts and then put it together is what it takes, and the endurance and just like, to not be anxious all the time. And then I also just like am the kind of workaholic that like won't leave ever. Like my roommate, my studio is like half an hour from my house, and my roommate called and was like, I haven't seen you in 2 months. Are you okay? And I was like, I just like can't leave. I was like fell asleep in front of the canvas, and like Tara brought me like a sandwich or whatever, like left it or whatever. So my answer is that I am not a healthy person.
Same. Yeah.
It shows in the quantity of work you created, though.
Trying to get better.
It'll pay off.
I've never been bit by like 100 mosquitoes in a day when we're carving. My old team and I were like, no matter how much off we put on ourselves, like it was just mosquitoes everywhere.
This is a great note to end on, so you know how much we torture our artists.
Exactly.
Awesome. It was the best. I don't want it to be over. I'm scared.
This has been so, so wonderful. We're going to hang out, you know, for like 10 minutes if you all want to come say hi and meet people. I want to point out there is a discount code on the back of your program for when this opens, which will be in the next couple of weeks. So at the beginning of October, these will be ready to see. And I just want to say thank you again, and hope all of our audience can help me in thanking the artists for coming up and sharing.